The last week of our New Zealand mission, we were in a town called Waimate. My husband and I stayed with the vicar of the church there, and she was a very kind lady. And one of the evenings, after we'd had dinner and were just sitting around talking, out of the blue, she said, we asked her whether she'd be interested in coming to Kenya. And she said she's never heard the Lord ask her, and really she has a story about Nairobi and Kenya that is not very good. So she started telling us about her brother who had been to Kenya to do mission work. He'd been with a group of missionaries in South Africa, and after the missionaries left, he decided to come up to Kenya to do Bible translation through puppeteering. And one of the evenings, he left his wherever he was staying and had walked to the shops along Gong Road and was attacked by thugs. He was found almost dead, and the good Samaritans who picked him took him to Kenyatta National Hospital. For 2 weeks, no one knew where he was. His family back in New Zealand never heard from him, and the hospital couldn't identify him, but he had a t-shirt that had something that they traced back to New Zealand, a company in New Zealand. So the Kenyan government sent word to New Zealand to ask whether there was a man missing from New Zealand. And when this family saw this in the news, they thought that could be their brother. So the family came together and decided to send their big brother here to come and check on him. This made big news in New Zealand. It was in the news every single day for 8 weeks. The brother came here and found that it was truly their brother. But he wasn't getting good medical care in Kenyatta Hospital. They moved him to Nairobi Hospital. Started therapy for so many weeks he couldn't talk. Finally took him back home. Started speech therapy, physiotherapy, and just rehabilitating him back to who he really was. When this lady started talking about it, we discovered that there was a lot of pain in her heart. Pain because she'd never talked about this for the last 20 years. Her brother was attacked in the country of these people that she's hosting. People who, according to her, she had chosen to love and forgive, while knowing very well they could be friends or relatives or people who know whoever attacked his brother, her brother. That was difficult for us because when she showed us the videos, she started crying. And we didn't know what to do at that point. And we let her cry, and at some point she started talking again, and we all started crying and prayed with her. And while praying, we posed as the thugs and asked her to forgive us on behalf of her family, to forgive us as a people from Kenya, to forgive our country. She said she forgives us, and we believe it's a healing process that began at that point. For us, the challenge was that here was somebody who knew that we'd come from the country where her brother was attacked and almost killed. And the pain for her was that they didn't kill her brother, but she always felt that they killed her father, because a few months after the brother went back home, her father passed on. He was too depressed and he had a heart attack and died. But it was amazing that God would bring us together and that she would open up to us and forgive us. And for us, a challenge is, as a country, are there people that we have, that we can't stand? Are there people that we hate? There's terrorism right now. 20 years later, Kenya is not any better in security. And there's terrorism and acts of violence. Many of us have lost family through terrorism, friends, people we knew. Post-election violence, many of us lost people we knew. Some people lost close relatives and property. What's the state of our heart in that sense? How are we loving our enemies and praying for those who are persecuting us? Might not be an instant reaction, but are we going through the process and asking the Lord to help us deal with these situations? Are we seeking healing from the Lord as a community?